Hey, what's up, everybody? This is Dante Fortson here with another episode that's going to be an addendum to the Unspoken documentary. Today, we're going to talk a little bit about Ishmael. We're going to talk a little bit about Isaac. And we're going to talk a lot about Arabia and that general area of the world that we now know as the Middle East. I'm going to show you guys some maps. And we're going to look a little bit at Sub-Saharan Africa, or what they call Sub-Saharan Africa and North Africa. This invisible boundary line that they placed between the majority of Africa and a small little teeny tiny section of Africa, as if that invisible boundary line stopped people from crossing over from one side to the other. So we're going to get into all that today. But before we do, today's episode is brought to you by the Judah 2 Onyx. No longer calling them black. Don't know why I didn't just call them Onyx since we had the gold and the platinum. But these are the Judah 2 Onyx. If you guys drop your name and email in the boxes right here, you will get sent out a discount code. And if you don't have your pair already, let me close this down. There we go. If you don't have your pair already, make sure to grab you a pair. Also, trying out the new vertical tab over here. I'm gonna see how it works. If you guys like the vertical tab, please press one. But if you prefer me to go back to the horizontal tab where they're all the way across top, please press two. And while you're pressing the ones and twos, please hit the thumbs up button. If you're new here, welcome. And just know everybody is welcome here. We're not going to ask you what your religion is. We're not going to ask you your political positions. We're not even going to ask you your gender. As long as you're chilled out and you're cool, everybody is welcome here to sit and listen. What you're not welcome to do is be disruptive or come in here preaching your own doctrines in the chat. We're not here to debate or have discussions. We're here to just take notes and look at the historical evidence. And that's basically what I stick to. I stick to the history. I may mention DNA, but I am not the DNA guy. I'm not the guy to ask me questions if you're E1, B1, ABCD, XYZ, any of that. I'm not the guy. Again, I will mention it if there's some kind of documentation I can read directly from, but I'm not the DNA guy. What I touch on here is history, and I give history in context of the Bible and show how it fits into the Bible. So for those of you who are new here, hit that subscribe button. You want to click the notification bell and turn on all notifications so you don't miss any future videos. And most importantly, after this is all done, please share these videos. Now, the Israelite Apologist Handbook is out for those who have not got their copy yet. All right, so this book right here is free, 100% free. All you have to do is go to blackhistoryinthebible.com and you can click right here, Israelite Apologist Handbook, or you can download the Black History in the Bible app. If you guys don't have the app, make sure you grab it. If you're on an iPhone, hit the little box at the button and then select add to home screen, and you'll add the app icon directly to your home screen and you can get to it that way for those of you who had trouble with the iPhone. But yeah, the Israelite Apologist Handbook version 1.0 is out now, and I am currently putting together the update for version 2.0. It should be out in maybe a week or so. So this is kind of an experimental type of book publication or book publishing experiment, I guess would have been better to say. But anyway, book publishing experiment, putting it out and then updating it as, you know, time progresses. So I'm going to be doing this. I have another one coming. For those of you who like this, if you have read through some of the Israelite Apologist Handbook, press one. If you have not, give me a two. And I'm going to be putting out a, what do you call those things? Not a documentary. I can't even think of the word right now. But you guys, oh, commentary. There we go. A commentary on Deuteronomy 28. I'm going to be dropping a verse-by-verse commentary on Deuteronomy 28. I'm going to do it right here on the blackhistoryinthebible.com website and app. And the commentary is going to kind of update as more historical information becomes available. So that will be free as well. All right. And finally, for the announcements. The New Testament Laws of Moses chart is now available. For those of you who have the Israelite Apologist Handbook, come down to Section 5, Charts and Downloads. You can click this one in the middle right here. It says coming soon. Let me see. Let me hit the refresh button over here. And there it is. Okay, I hadn't refreshed this page since I uploaded the chart, but the chart is there. So you guys can grab your copy. This is version 1.0 of the chart. And I'm going to be updating this chart soon as well. It will probably be out just after the 2.0 update of the Israelite Apologist Handbook. Getting some good information coming in, just listening to these people talk. All we got to do is listen to them talk, listen to the points they bring up, and then I'll go in, update the handbook, and you guys will have the latest information so you can adjust your approach to witnessing to people. And speaking of witnessing, for those of you who are listening and you don't know the love and forgiveness of the Messiah of Israel, I invite you to go read Romans 10, chapter 10, verses 8 through 13. Believe in your heart and confess with your mouth that Christ came and God raised him from the dead and thou shalt be saved. That's just a condensed version. But go read Romans 10, 8 through 13. All right. So now we're about to jump into today's study. And the reason I'm doing this study on the Unspoken documentary, or as an addendum to the Unspoken documentary, is because I know that they are trying to push a narrative. They're not trying to educate. Their goal is to indoctrinate Black people into a way of thinking that leads us to believe that we are nobody special to God. We mean nothing to God outside of the other people who interacted with us, and we're just all a part of the human race. Nothing significant happened with the transatlantic slave trade. It doesn't mean anything that we were scattered worldwide. This is what they want us to believe. They want to indoctrinate us that the Bible is not the white man's religion, but it is also not the Black man's religion. And the reason I know that this is the narrative they want to push is because it's the narrative they have been pushing. And they only have two parts to their documentary planned. But as you guys have seen, if you watch part one, if you have not, go watch it. But in part one, it was about an hour and 40 something minutes long of me giving you history. And even if you take out the 15 minutes of, you know, me talking about whatever randomly, let's just say 30 minutes. Let's just say take out the whole 44 minutes and say for 44 minutes, I didn't give you any information, which you guys can go back and look and see. And let's just say I only gave you straight information for an hour. Well, if they only have two documentaries planned and I gave you an hour worth of information last time and they don't plan to cover any or very little of that information in their documentary, ask yourself how much stuff are they leaving out of that documentary? How do they plan to teach Black involvement in the Bible or Black involvement in relation to the Bible if they're going to leave out the majority of the information? The reason I'm taking my time going through this is so that we don't leave out important information and so that we come away with a greater understanding. And as always, these links to all the sources will be in the description. There will be a link that takes you to the source page and all the sources will be linked there, including all the biblical references now. I didn't used to include the Bible verses because you guys could go look those up yourself, but I am now including the Bible verses in the reference list. All right. So this right here, this is going to be how some people define the Middle East. Not always, but usually the Middle East is going to encompass a huge part of, well, let's just come over here. This green is going to encompass all this green. Sometimes it's going to encompass this orange, not on every single map. And even less, I see it all the way this far. Usually it comes over to about right here to Turkmenistan and Afghanistan, roughly. And then it starts to, you know, get into Asia and Europe. But this is actually the broadest it gets is up here into Kazakhstan. If you guys have seen Borat, if I'm not mistaken, Borat's character is said to be from Kazakhstan. Borat is not a real person, by the way. I think that's his name, Sasha Michelle. He played Ali G and some other characters. But yeah, if you've seen the Borat movies, this is the general area that Borat is said to be from. And you see what Borat looks like. But anyway, some people consider this to be the Middle East. Now over here, if you read some of this down here, Central Asia, Caucasus, where you get the term Caucasian from, this is going to be the core area of the Middle East. And then they call this the Maghrib. So when you hear the term Maghrib come up, which it will, especially when you talk about languages, Maghribian Arab is going to be one of those languages. Now, you guys can correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe it refers to the Arabic languages that come out of this area, Libya, Algeria, Tunisia, and Morocco. So you'll hear that term Maghrib come up often when we research this topic. Now, another area you need to be familiar with is sub-Saharan Africa versus North Africa. So this area right here is going to be considered North Africa in addition to it being included with the Middle East. Now, earlier I was talking about the invisible boundary lines. So this right here demonstrates the invisible boundary line. Everything in color is considered sub-Saharan Africa. Everything up here is considered North Africa. So you have the Western Sahara, it says disputed. Sometimes you will see it included in sub-Saharan Africa. Sometimes you will not. Then you have Morocco, Algeria, Tunisia, Libya, and Egypt. These are all considered North Africa. And so when you start to get into this subject, people have this invisible boundary line. All these lines you see separating the countries, most of you guys are old enough to understand that these lines don't physically exist. These are imaginary lines that separate people into different groups and locations and make it easier to determine countries. And so people, when they talk about North Africa and sub-Saharan Africa, they are under the impression that somehow this invisible boundary line right here didn't allow these people to come mix with these people, or for these people to come up here and mix with these people over here. But as we will see, when we get deeper into this, we're going to see that people come into Egypt from all over Arabia and from Asia. They come down into Egypt, and from Egypt, they end up in Sudan and Ethiopia. That's how Ham and his family begin to populate Africa. They came down in the Caucasus Mountains up this way, and then they migrated over into here, according to the Bible. And as they migrated, this is why you have Hamites that ended up building civilizations over here. I'm going to show you guys that map in a minute. But you have Hamites that build civilization over here, and then they come over in here, and you have this called the Land of Ham. And then later on, we get into some of the migrations of Israel. They come down in through Yemen, across over here, and end up down in Zimbabwe. And then you're going to have other ones who migrate from Egypt over into Central Africa, roughly around here. You got Central African Republic, but roughly around here. And then they're going to migrate over into West Africa, where you're going to find the slave coast. Later on, they're going to come from Spain and Portugal up this way. And they didn't migrate. They were deported over into West Africa, the islands of Sao Tome and Principe. So we're going to look at these African migrations. So now we're going to refer to these maps again, but I just want you guys to have a general basic understanding of what we call the Middle East, what we call North Africa, and what we call Sub-Saharan Africa, and how it's used when we're talking about these subjects in general, but more specifically in relation to the Bible. All right, so let's look at something I mentioned before but didn't pull up the verse last time around. I mentioned that Abraham was a Hebrew, and that the word Hebrew comes from Eber, or is believed to come from Eber, who was a descendant of Shem. And so now in Genesis 14, 13, we see Abraham called a Hebrew, but we'll start reading in verse 10. And the vale of Siddim was full of slime pits, and the kings of Sodom and Gomorrah fled and fell there, and they that remained fled to the mountain. So I should have started. Actually, you know what? I'm going to go back up a little bit just to give you guys a quick overview of history. Just because we did speak on the Gentiles and some of the other stuff going on. Now, if you come to Genesis chapter 14, which is where we are, you have the War of the Kings. You have four kings and five kings. And I just want to point a few things out that I pointed out to other people. And, you know, some people notice it, some people don't. And it came to pass in the days of Amraphel, king of Shinar, Arioch, king of Eleazar, Shedolomar, king of Elam, we spoke on the Elamites, and Tidal, king of nations. This word right here is Goyim or Goy, the word we get Gentiles from. And so my first question, how do we have a guy here named Tidal, king of nations or king of the Gentiles, if the Gentiles are everybody except for Jews? See, in the church, we were taught, and let me not even be general when I say in the church, some Christian doctrine teaches that everybody who is not a Jew is automatically a Gentile. And yet in Genesis 14, or going back to Genesis 10, we find that Japheth specifically is associated with the Gentiles. And then we get to Genesis 14 and we find Tidal, king of the Gentiles, or king of the nations, or king of the Goyim. It says that these made war with Bera, king of Sodom, and Bersha, king of Gomorrah, Shinab, king of Admah, and Shemeber, king of Zeboim, and the king of Bela, which is Zoar. You're going to recognize these cities because these cities are going to come back up later when with the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah. People talk about the Sodom and Gomorrah incident, but there were actually five cities involved, and Lot managed to get one of the cities spared, so only four cities were destroyed out of the five because Lot simply asked. And I find the story of Sodom and Gomorrah interesting because it starts off with Abraham. Abraham wanted to save the cities if, you know, they could find, well, he got down to 10 righteous people and they couldn't find 10 righteous people. But Lot said, hey, I need to escape to this other city because there's stuff in the mountains. If you guys have not seen my Nephilim Giants series, go check that out. I talk about why Lot may have, I'm not saying he was 100% for this reason, but may have been afraid to flee to the mountains. There were things in the mountains. There were something other than the normal people in those mountains. And I get into that and use nothing but, well, I ain't gonna say nothing but I use scripture and I use some historical documents to back what I'm saying. So it says, these made war with Bera, king of Sodom, with Bersha, king of Gomorrah, Shinab, king of Admah, and Shemeber, king of Zeboim, and the king of Bela, which is Zoar. All these were joined together in the Vale of Siddim, which is the Salt Sea. 12 years they served Shedolomar, and in the 13th year they rebelled. So they served Shedolomar, king of Elam. They served the Elamites. And I showed you, if you have not watched part one, I showed you, I pulled up Harry Johnston that said Elam was a Negroid, or the Elamites were Negroid people. In fact, let me see here. See if I can find it on the side. I put all this on the side, hopefully thinking, there it is right here, it would help. So let's go back here real quick. Let's close this and let's zoom in. The Elamites of Mesopotamia appear to have been a Negroid people with kinky hair and to have transmitted this racial type to the Jews and Syrians. There's a curliness of the hair. Let me scoot this over some. There's a curliness of the hair together with the Negro eye and full lips in the portraiture of Assyria, which conveys the idea of an evident Negro element in Babylonia. Quite probably the very ancient Negro invasion of Mediterranean Europe, of which the skeletons of the Alps Maritimes are vestiges, came from Syria and Asia Minor on its way to Central and Western Europe. All right, so now we're gonna go through some interesting stuff today. I'm gonna show you guys some more documents that back that. And matter of fact, let me pull up an image of the Elamites real quick before we move on. All right, so I went ahead and Googled Shushan Palace. Now you will find Shushan Palace in the Bible. You will find it under the name Susa, S-U-S-A, if you're looking for modern history. So it says Shushan Palace on the outskirts of the city of Shush in western Iran lie the remains of Shushan, winter palace of the kings of Persia and the setting of the Bible book of Esther. So yeah, you guys, Genesis 10, you want to see the Elamites come from Shem. Now, this is one of the pieces of art in Shushan Palace. And let me get up. Here's a bigger one right here. So we'll wait for that to load 100%. As you can see, these are the Elamite archers. We went over this last time. I didn't show this many pictures, but you guys can see what the Elamites looked like. The Elam was a direct son of Shem. You guys can see this, and you have to ask yourself, if they don't show this in the unspoken documentary series that they are coming out with, ask yourself, why is it they won't tell you this? Why don't they want you to know that the descendants of Shem's son was black? Shem's son, Elam. So these are the Elamites. So let me go back up. All right, so now these made war with Bera, king of Sodom. Oh, wait, I already read that. It says, 12 years they served Chedorlaomer, and in the 13th year they rebelled. And in the 14th year came Chedorlaomer and the kings that were with him and smote the Rephaims. These are tribes of giants mentioned in the Bible, in Ashtaroth, Karnaim, and the Zuzims in Ham, and the Emims in Shava Kirithaim, and the Horites in their Mount Seir unto El Paran, which is by the wilderness. So this is where we talk about Lot and why he didn't want to escape to those mountains. Because as a tactical move, when the war broke out and the kings of Sodom and Gomorrah and the other ones rebelled against the king of Elam, Chedorlaomer, he began to kill these giants. Why? Probably militarily, strategically, because they were allies, possibly, of those other nations. Possibly. We don't get this in the Bible, but just strategically, based on what we see occur throughout Scripture. What we see occur in Sodom. People make Sodom and Gomorrah about homosexuality specifically, but there was something bigger going on, because remember, Abraham said, will you spare the city? If God was going to say, you know what? No, I don't want to spare it at all. He could have just said no. He didn't have to negotiate with Abraham. He didn't even negotiate. He didn't have to let Abraham talk him down to 10 people. He could have just said, no, I'm not going to spare it because of this, you know, this one act that they're doing right here. But we see that later on when the angels come into town, Lot was sitting outside the gates of the city just fine. He wasn't bothered. Lot was living in the city unbothered. His daughters were virgins living in the city unbothered. Their sons-in-law were living in the city unbothered. The men weren't trying to have sex with just any old random man. And then when these other two angels came into the city, all the men of the city wanted those two specifically. For what reason? I'll leave that to y'all to figure out. Check out my Nephilim Giants series. So they come over here, they smite the land of the Amalekites, the Amorites. We're not going to get into all that. And then this is going to lead up to the Sodom and Gomorrah. And right here, Abraham's nephew Lot gets kidnapped. Right here it says, and the vale of Siddim was full of slime pits, and the kings of Sodom and Gomorrah fled and fell there, and they that remained fled to the mountain. And they took all the goods of Sodom and Gomorrah and all their victuals and went their way. And they took Lot, Abraham's brother's son, or his nephew, who dwelt in Sodom, and his goods, and departed. So Lot is now a kidnapped victim, and Abraham now has to go get his brother's son back, which would have been his brother's job had his brother not died. And so you will get some elements of the law in here, where a man is supposed to raise up seed for his brother if his brother dies without any seed. But Abraham's brother did have seed, Lot, and so him being in that fatherly position now, it is now his responsibility to get his family back, his brother's, you know, son back. It says, and there came one that had escaped and told Abram the Hebrew. So Abraham was already a Hebrew. Abram the Hebrew. Abraham was not a Gentile. We know he was not a Gentile, because if Abraham was a Gentile, he would have lived under Tidal, king of the Gentiles, or the Goyim. So we know that Abraham is not a Goyim, because Tidal is king of the Goyim, and Abraham would have had to commit treason. Well, not technically treason. Abraham wasn't on nobody's side in this war. Abraham just wanted his family back. So these made war with the king of Sodom and Gomorrah. So Abraham, well, yeah, technically it would have been, let me see, let me make sure. Let me make sure. All right, so no, Abraham wouldn't have been committing treason, but Abraham did not live under title. I just wanted to make sure I didn't have which of the armies were on which side wrong. All right, so Abraham would not have been committing treason, but Abraham would have been subservient to title king of the Gentiles if Abraham himself was a Gentile. My point is Abraham was a Hebrew. For he dwelt in the plain of Mamre, the Amorite. So if you guys do some research on the Amorites, you'll see who they are. Brother of Eshcol and brother of Aner. So there's three of them. And they were confederate with Abram. So Abraham had his own alliances. Because remember, Lot and Abraham split because the land wasn't big enough to support all of them. So Abraham had alliances. And so when Abraham went after these people, he probably didn't go alone. He had his trained servants. It says, and when Abram heard that his brother was taken captive, not his brother, but his nephew, and you will find that the terminology is different. When you read through the King James, you will never see the word grandfather, grandmother, grandson, or granddaughter in the King James. So, for instance, my grandfather, I would still be referred to him as they would still refer to me as his son, and they would refer to him as my father. My great, 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 great grandfather would be referred to as my father. Them collectively would be referred to as my fathers, and I would still be referred to them or referred to as their son, no matter how many generations above me there were. Same thing, you will find that nephew. Sometimes I don't believe you see nephew or niece. You might. I've seen it, but I can't remember if it's in the NKJV or not. So I'm liberty to say you won't, but you'll see stuff like this where it calls Abraham or called Lot Abraham's brother. It's not a contradiction. Some people say, well, look, that's a contradiction. It's not a contradiction. So when Abraham heard that his brother was taken captive, he armed his trained servants born in his own house, 318, and pursued them unto Dan. Now, Dan did not exist yet. We're talking about Abraham, but remember, the Genesis was written by Moses, and Dan did exist at the time of Moses. So Moses was given his current geography to talk about past events, kind of like how we call the land of Canaan. We call it Israel, even when we're talking about the Bible, and we may use it interchangeably, but oftentimes people will say Israel. And he divided himself against them, he and his servants by night, and smote them and pursued them unto Hobah, which is on the left hand of Damascus. And he brought back all the goods and also brought back his brother Lot and his goods and the women also and the people. So Abraham didn't just go get his nephew. He went and got everybody and everything. So that's what I wanted to touch on real quick. So now we're going to fast forward because we made it to Ishmael last time. And so we reached the death of Abraham right here. Let's see. We'll start here and we're going to read through Genesis 25. The last part of this presentation, you're going to like it. It's going to be mostly images, mostly. But I am going to give you guys a bunch of good references. So let's read about the death of Abraham. Then again, Abraham took a wife and her name was Keturah. So this is Abraham's third wife. Abraham had Sarah, through whom Isaac came. He had Hagar, who we touched on, who was a Hamite, and that's who Ishmael came through. And now Abraham is going to take a third wife named Keturah. We don't know where she came from, but there is a possibility that she was also it could have been someone he met later on. It could have been a possibility she came from Egypt. We don't know for sure. There are books that, you know, claim that what they claim. I'll say it that way. And she bare him Zimram. So these are Abraham's children. We always talk about Isaac and Ishmael, but Abraham had other kids. She bare him Zimram and Jokshan and Medan and Midian and Ishbak and Shua. That is six. Let me count them again. Zimram, Jokshan, Medan, Midian, Ishbak, and Shua. That's six. Plus Isaac and Ishmael make eight children of Abraham. So Abraham had a total of eight. And Midian, we're going to see come up again in the Exodus because Moses flees to Midian, which is where Zipporah is from. Zipporah is a Midianite. So she is a descendant of Abraham. The problem is later on, Abraham also takes a Cushite wife. And people try to equate the Cushite wife to Miriam, which you can't do because Miriam is from the line of Shem through Abraham's son Midian, and the Cushites come through Ham's son Cush. So people want to avoid the very real fact that Moses had two wives. But we're not going to get into that right now. We'll get into that when we get to it. And the sons of Midian, Ephah and Epher and Hanok and Abida and Elda, all these were the children of Keturah. And Abraham gave all that he had unto Isaac. So he just was like, hey, I know y'all my kids, but yeah, I'm going to go give all the stuff unto Isaac. But he's going to give them some stuff. But it says he gave all that he had. It doesn't mean every literal last thing that he had. Because we're going to see here that's he gave his other kids stuff too. But unto the sons of the concubines, which Abraham had, Abraham gave gifts and sent them away from Isaac, his son, while he yet lived, eastward unto the east country. So Abraham had seven other kids. Now, we're going to find something interesting. Six of them he sent away. I'm going to show you why it's six of them that he sent away, and it wasn't, Ishmael wasn't included in this group. Now, it says the sons of the concubines. Now, Ishmael is going to go his separate way, but Ishmael doesn't get sent away to the east with these people. So now, when we talk about descendancy, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob Jacob is descended from Abraham. But you're also going to find that there are people who were sent eastward that are also related to Abraham, which is why we may sometimes get confused when it comes to the DNA, when people start to mix in. Just because someone's lineage traces back to Abraham does not mean they trace back to Israel. And we don't have Abraham's body for DNA. Again, I'm not the DNA guy, but I know we don't have Abraham's body for it. And these are the days of the years of Abraham's life, which he lived 103 years or 175 years. Then Abraham gave up the ghost and died in a good old age, an old man and full of years, and was gathered to his people. That's what the Most High told him in Genesis 15. You shall die in a good old age and be gathered to your people. Genesis 25 is a clear fulfillment of Genesis chapter 15, verse, I believe, 15. Matter of fact, let's look and make sure. I believe it's verse 15. And thou shalt go to thy fathers in peace and shall be buried in a good old age. All right, so he was 175 when he died, and that's what happened. He gave up the ghost. He went to his fathers in peace. So now we're going to jump back over here. Oh, wait, I clicked the wrong thing. Genesis 25. All right. So now, then Abraham gave up the ghost and died in a good old age, an old man full of years, and was gathered to his people. And his sons, Isaac and Ishmael. This is what I meant when I said they weren't all sent away, because Ishmael is here with Isaac now. So the other six were sent away. Now, Isaac and Ishmael buried him in the cave of Machpelah in the field of Ephron, the son of Zoar the Hittite, which is before Mamre. And remember, the Hittites come from Heth. And Heth was a descendant of Ham. We covered this in part one. We're going to walk all the way through this thing. And so now we understand who Abraham bought his cave from. He bought it from the Hittites. We skipped over that part, but that's what happened. He bought the cave from the Hittites, and now Isaac and Ishmael are burying him there. The field which Abraham purchased of the sons of Heth, there was Abraham buried and Sarah his wife. So they both were buried in a field, in a cave that was purchased from Hamites. And it came to pass after the death of Abraham, that God blessed his son Isaac, and Isaac dwelt by the well of Laharoi. So now, after the death of Abraham, God blesses Isaac. But remember, we read before that it was by the when Hagar thought she was going to die, God blessed Ishmael. He had already previously blessed Ishmael, and so now Isaac gets his blessing after Abraham dies. Now we're going to talk a little bit about the descendants of Ishmael, and I'm going to show a map. Now, these are the generations of Ishmael, Abraham's son, when Hagar, the Egyptian, Sarah's handmaid, bare. Oh, let me start over. Now, these are the generations of Ishmael, Abraham's son, whom Hagar, the Egyptian, Sarah's handmaid, bare unto Abraham. And these are the names of the sons of Ishmael by their names, according to their generations, the firstborn of Ishmael, Nebajoth. and Kedar and Abdil and Mibsam. We're going to come back to Kedar in a second. And Mishma and Duma and Massa, Hadar and Tema and Jeter, Naphish and Kedema. These are the sons of Ishmael, and these are their names by their towns and by their castles, 12 princes according to their nations. So Jacob is going to have 12. And we also see that Ishmael has 12 princes according to their nations. And remember, Ishmael is half Hamite because his mother was Hagar, a Hamite. And these are the years of the life of Ishmael, 137 years, and he gave up the ghost and died and was gathered unto his people. And they dwelt from Havilah to Shur, that is before Egypt, as thou goest toward Assyria. And he died in the presence of all his brethren. So they lived from Shur to Egypt. So now I want to show you guys something. Let me see here. Okay, so now, from Havilah to Shur as you go is towards Syria. I believe this is Syria. Let me make sure. Yep, that's Syria right there. So, Havilah to Shur. Some people put Havilah over here. I'm going to show you guys the other map. Let me see which one. Right here. So now, some people put Havilah down here at the bottom. Let me move this off of here. Down here at the bottom, you'll see Havilah. So Shur is right here as you go towards Syria. So some people will believe they were down here, up to here. And then you have some people place Havilah over here. And I'm going to show you guys again where they have Havilah. So you have the Sinai Peninsula here. You're going to have Egypt here. This small sliver is modern day Israel, but we can't forget that God promised the Israelites from the great river, the river of Egypt to the great river Euphrates, which includes part of Africa, not just this little sliver of land. If anybody involved in any kind of religion, any kind of belief system, any kind of historical teaching tells you that this little sliver of land was what was promised to Israel, they are not only lying, it tells you they don't know what they're talking about when it comes to the Bible. That's not what God promised. God promised from the Nile River to the Euphrates, which many people believe is over here. I'm not sure if these are rivers or I think these are country designations. They're not showing the rivers on here. But the Euphrates River is somewhere up in here, and the Nile is roughly over in here. So all this was promised to Israel, not just this little sliver. But for those who place Havilah here, they believe that Ishmael inhabited this area over here near modern day Israel. So it just gives you an idea of where we're talking about. Now, I mentioned we're going to talk about Kedar, and we're going to come back to Isaac. So now Kedar, if you look up the name meanings, which is interesting, it says, Arabic baby name meanings. I just want to get on these. This is on sheknows.com, baby names. Arabic baby name meanings. In Arabic baby names, the meaning of the name Kedar is strong. Biblical names meaning. So we're in the Bible. In biblical names, the meaning of the name Kedar is blackness, sorrow. So now, I find it interesting that we encounter terminology in the Bible. Whenever we see the word black, they try to say, well, black doesn't mean black. It really means sorrow. But then we see terms like white. When it works in their favor, they will interpret that to mean that the person is white and not that it's talking about sin. Because though your sins be as black as, what do they say, red as scarlet, he'll make them white as snow. So you have colors used to express different things. You have scarlet used to express sin. You have white used to express purity, and you also have blackness used to express sorrow, but then you also have the literal meanings of those words. And we will find that when people don't want to acknowledge certain things, they swap out those words or they make up stories around those words. Job 30:30 is a perfect example of that when he says, my skin is black upon me. Well, then they will give you a reason why his skin was black. Not that he just was black, but there has to be a reason for his skin to be black. And they will say that's because he poured ashes on himself. Well, I encourage y'all to go pour ash. No, don't pour it. Find a person who's willing to participate. let me rephrase that, because you know they try to take stuff out of context. Find someone who is willing to participate in the experiment, a black person and a white person. Pour ashes on them both and see if their skin becomes black upon them. Now, again, make sure they're willing to participate. Don't just go pour no ashes on nobody. All right, just want to make sure I say that before they take it out of context. So now I'm on babynames.com. Kedar, gender, male, origin, Hebrew, meaning dark one. Dark one. Now, does this make sense in context of history? I always talk about historical consistency. We had part one. We talked about who was who. We showed you that even in older texts, they said Shem was dark. We showed you that Ham was dark. Showed you the documentation. It says the son of Shem, Elam, was a Negro. He had Negroid features, kinky hair, so on and so forth. And then now we get down to Abraham, who is a descendant of the same people of the Shemites, or who is a Shemite. And he has a son with an Egyptian woman. So if Abraham descends from a dark people, and we know that the Hamites are dark people, and Hagar is a Hamite, and Abraham's descended from a dark person that probably looked just like the Elamites, and they get together and they make a child named Ishmael, and then Ishmael's son comes along, or Abraham's grandson, and his name means dark one. What is the likelihood that it's referring to his skin color? That's all I'm going to say. I'm going to keep reading. The name Kedar is primarily a male name of Hebrew origin and means dark one. In the Bible, Kedar was Ishmael's second son, also an Arabic name meaning powerful. So it means one thing in Arabic, one thing in Hebrew. Why is that important? We're going to find that people from other countries often tend to, I'll say outside of America, some of y'all are not in America listening, some of y'all are outside of America, but they often speak more than one language. Usually they're going to speak Hebrew, possibly Arabic, maybe some French, definitely some English, very likely some Mandarin. But yeah, it's important to understand all this. And we're going to get into some of this, you know, other cultures based on this study. Kedar, a son of Ishmael, Hebrew, Kedar, it tells you where to find it in King James Bible. This is from quotescosmos.com. All right there, quotes cosmos. Here is Kedar in the Bible. What does the source Hebrew word mean and how is it used in the Bible? Below are the English definition details. Also below are examples within Bible verses highlighted in yellow. Follow the link to go there. Tap or hover on blue. Underline words to see more original scripture and meaning. Information sourced from Strong's Concordance. Definition and details. So you'll find that the opposition wants to start bashing stuff now. Now the King James ain't good enough. You need a different version because they don't like what Deuteronomy 28 says. So now you need a different version in the King James, and then they want to knock everybody else for using it. Then you use the Strong's Concordance, which has been used for decades in churches, not just the black church, but in many churches. Now the Strong's ain't going to be good enough. You got to get a different kind of concordance. There are better ones out there now. So you'll find that they constantly move the goalposts. So Strong's number H6938, proper name, Kedar, literally dark. Definition, Kedar, son of Ishmael, also collectively Bedouin as his descendants or representatives. So it says the Bedouins descend from Kedar. We're going to look into the Bedouins in a second. Son of Ishmael, the descendants of Kedar, derived terms, dusky, of the skin or tint. So his name means dark or dark one, and a derived term from that is this one right here. You guys can click this if you want to. Again, the links will be in the description. Is dusky, of the skin or the tent. This is important. I'm going to show you guys why. Again, dusky, of the skin or the tent, meaning it's referring to his skin color. All right, here we go. Song of Solomon. This is not talking about Solomon, so please don't hit me up asking me about Solomon saying he's black. Some of y'all need to really read slow and yeah, just really, really read through this. The young Shulamites, Shulamite bride and Jerusalem's daughters. So Yeah, read through this real slow. It's not Solomon talking about himself. Right here in Song of Solomon, chapter 1, verses 5 through 7. I was wondering why I wasn't saying that right. I am black but comely, O ye daughters of Jerusalem, as the tents of Kedar, as the curtains of Solomon. So we know that the curtains of Solomon were black. We know that the tents of Kedar is black. And this is what you call a simile when they use the word like or as. And one of the most embarrassing things I think that happens in specifically the black church is that people call things metaphors that are not metaphors when they're actually similes, or they say something is an idiom when it's not actually an idiom, or they tell you something is vision when it's not actually vision, or they try to interpret something literal as figurative. It's like they have no grasp on the language at all whatsoever, and they just apply whatever meaning they want. This is a simile. It's when you compare something factual with something else factual to emphasize the point you want to make or to give people a clear picture. It says, I am black but comely, black but beautiful. Some people say, well, that just means they were sad. I'm sad but beautiful, O ye daughters of Jerusalem, as the tents of Kedar, as the curtains of Solomon. That doesn't make sense. I am black. It's talking about skin color. But how do we know it's talking about skin color? Because right here in verse 6, look not upon me because I am black, because the sun hath looked down upon me. My mother's children were angry with me, and they made me the keeper of the vineyards, but mine own vineyard have I not kept. So wait, what do we see in that verse that indicates that this is literally about skin color? Look not upon me because I am black. Why are they black? Because the sun hath looked down upon me. So what happens when someone stays out in the sun too long? They get dark. A black person will get darker. I am black like the tents of Kedar, like the curtains of Solomon. Are the curtains of Solomon tanned Caucasian? Are the tents of Kedar tanned Caucasian? Please press 1 if you believe that the tents of Kedar are tanned Caucasian tents, or the curtains of Solomon are tanned Caucasian in color. Press 2 if you do not believe that nonsense. So now, it starts off with a simile, a comparison of other things black. Then we have an explanation. Look not upon me because I am black. I'm black because the sun has looked down upon me. Why has the sun looked down upon you so much that you are black? Well, my mother's children were angry with me, and they made me keeper of the vineyards. Where are the vineyards? They're outside. Outside in the what? Outside in the sun. So the sun would shine down on somebody and make them dark. But my own vineyard have I not kept. We know this is literal because in some newer translations, they try to switch that word black with the word tanned. Hold on. Let me see if I can find one. I'm going to find that one real quick, but I looked in the ESV first because I wasn't sure. I'm not too familiar with the ESV like I am some of the others, but right here it says, I am very dark. I am very dark, but lovely, O daughters of Jerusalem, like the tents of Kedar, like the curtains of Solomon. Do not gaze at me because I am dark, because the sun has looked upon me. My mother's sons were angry with me. They made me keeper of the vineyards, but my own vineyard have I not kept. So hold on. Let me find the other one where it says tanned. All right, here we go. This is in the New King James Version, the NKJV. I am dark but lovely, O daughters of Jerusalem, like the tents of Kedar, like the curtains of Solomon. Do not look upon me because I am dark, because the sun has tanned me. My mother's sons were angry with me. They made me the keeper of the vineyards, but my own vineyard have I not kept. So this right here, they take this tanned me and ignore the dark part, the black part. They ignore all of the other stuff and say, well, see, it just means they were tanned. Dark doesn't mean dark. They were swarthy. Hold on. Let me give y'all some other medicine. All right, I just put up this parallel Bible on BibleStudyTools.com. So right here in the American Standard Version, look not upon me because I am swarthy. See, this is why some of them want to change the meaning of the word. Swarthy doesn't mean black. Swarthy could mean a European. Black doesn't mean black. It just means sorrow. Right here uses dark. The Bible in Basic English uses dark. Darkened by the sun's gaze in Common English Bible. Common English with Apocrypha, again, darkened. A complete Jewish Bible. I'm dark, the sun tanned me. Dark, the sun gazed on me. Black, Darby translation, dark here. Don't look down on me because of my color, because the sun has tanned me. They removed 100%, just remove the reference to being black. That's interesting. The Good News Translation with Apocrypha: do not look down on me because of my color. Stop staring at me because I am so dark. God's Word Translation: don't stare at me because I'm dark. But anyway, y'all see. But anyway, the point was about Kedar. So let's keep going and read a little bit more about Kedar. We're going to read about the Kedarites and the Nabataeans. I hope I'm saying that right. Maybe I'm not. So Kedar, and we already seen them linked to the Bedouins. A nomadic tribe, this is from jewishvirtuallibrary.org. A nomadic tribe or league of tribes in the Arabian desert. Kedar is mentioned in Genesis 25:3 and 1 Chronicles 1:29 among the sons of Ishmael, the latter being tribes of Arabs known from the 8th century BC onward in the desert tracts surrounding Palestine. So wait a minute. We know Kedar is the son of a Hamite and the son of a Shemite. And we know that historically both were believed to be dark people. So they come together. And now it's saying that the descendants of Ishmael are Arabs that are around Palestine. Now, Arab is going to refer to those on the Arabian Peninsula. The mode of life of the Kedarites, as reflected in the Bible, was associated with the rearing of sheep and camels and with the dwelling in tents and in unfortified villages and camps. Biblical information on their locality and history is extremely scant, but many details about these are known from other sources, in particular from inscriptions of Assyrian kings. The earliest documents which refers to the Kedarites is the inscription of Tiglath-Pileser III found in Iran. Let me go back to the map real quick. Let me make sure. So you have Iran here. And remember, when we looked at the Elamite territory, it was roughly around here. The mouse ain't super accurate. But the Elamite territory was roughly in this area in modern day Iran. And then Assyria is going to be somewhere up in here. Iran is part of the ancient Assyrian Empire. I'll get into the details of that later. That's not the whole of it. But so anyway, let me keep reading. Let me go back. The earliest document refers to the Kedarites here. Let me see. In it, they are mentioned together with other nations in the west of the Fertile Crescent who surrendered to the Assyrian king and whose rulers paid him tribute to 738 BCE. From parallel inscriptions of Ashurbanipal, it is evident that Hazael, king of the Arabs, against whom Sennacherib's army fought between 691 and 689 BCE, or BC if you prefer, in the region of Duma in Wadi Sirhan, and who surrendered to Esarhaddon, was the king of Kedar, close to 652 BC. The Kedarites under Uate, the son of Hazael, who broke his oath of allegiance to, let's just call him Ash, raided the frontier regions on the western border of the Assyrian Empire, but were repulsed and defeated by King Kama of Moab and by units of the Assyrian army stationed along the border from the valley of Lebanon to Edom. We're not going to get into the full history of Kedar, but if you guys want to, you can go through and read all about this. The wide dispersion of the Kedarites, extending as it did from the region of Duma in Wadi Saran to Palmyrene and the eastern port of the Nile Delta, lends probability to there having been a union of various subunits. Evidence of the existence of such a social organization occurs in the inscriptions of Ash, according to which Uate, son of Hazael, and Amuladi flourished at the same time, and in which both are referred to as kings or king of Kedar. Similarly, Ezekiel 27:21 refers to Arabia and all the princes of Kedar. So that's interesting. Let's go check Ezekiel 27:21. All right, here we are like magic. Arabia and all the princes of Kedar, they occupied with thee in lambs and rams and goats, and these were they thy merchants. So it mentions Arabia and all the princes of Kedar. So why is it that we're led to believe that that Arabia was mostly light-skinned or looked the way it does today, when it seems that history and the biblical narrative are telling a different story? Now, we haven't even got to Jacob yet. We're not even to Israel yet. We're still talking about Abraham's children, Ishmael. We haven't even got to Isaac just yet. We're going to Isaac in a second. So the Kedarites, I'm going to start here. And so we're going to show you. So we're going to show you some consistency. So like I said, some people believed Havilah was this direction and Shur was here. Some people believe Havilah was down here. It's possible we had more than one Havilah. That does occur in history, to where you have more than one territory named after a person with the same name. So that does happen. It doesn't make it a contradiction. So right here, this is the area that they are believed to inhabit. And remember, I'll show you guys right here. Give me a second. Right here. This is from BibleStudyTools.com. This is not an Israelite website. Kedar, dark-skinned, the second son of Ishmael. It is the name for the nomadic tribes of Arabs, the Bedouins generally, who dwelt in the northwest of Arabia. They lived in black hair tents. To dwell in the tents of Kedar was to be cut off from the worship of the true God. Not sure where they got that from. But anyway, the Kedarites suffered at the hand of Nebuchadnezzar. So this is the same Kedar we're talking about. So the Kedarites we're talking about, largely nomadic ancient Arabian tribal confederation. So they are descended from Abraham. So the Arabs over here, these Kedarites are descended from Abraham. Let me see if I can get a bigger picture here. Here we go. So the Kedarites dwelt over here. This is near Goshen, where Israel was, all the way over into a huge chunk of the Arabian Peninsula. I can't scroll down. So now this is going to become important, because we're going to start looking through some of this. So let me go back here and we're going to read some of this. And we're not going to we're not going to read all this. I'm just going to read this chunk right here, and then we're going to move on. At the peak of its power, let me see, described as the most organized of the northern Arabian tribes, at the peak of its power in the 6th century BCE, it had a kingdom and controlled a vast region in Arabia. Biblical tradition holds that the Kedarites are named for Kedar, the second son of Ishmael, mentioned in the Bible's books of Genesis 25 and 1 Chronicles 1:29. So that's what we were just reading, right? We were just reading Genesis 25. We were reading about Kedar. And then we also looked at Bible Study Tools. It says dark skinned, the second son of Ishmael. So we're confirming it. We're talking about the same people here. The biblical tradition holds, we read this, where there are also frequent references to Kedar as a tribe. The earliest extra-biblical inscriptions discovered by archaeologists that mention the Kedarites are from the Neo-Assyrian Empire. Spanning the 8th and 7th centuries BCE, they list the names of Kedarite kings who revolted and were defeated in battle, as well as those who paid Assyrian monarchs tribute, including Zabib, queen of the Arabs. There are also Aramaic and old southern Arabian inscriptions recalling the Kedarites, who further appear briefly in the writings of classical Greek, such as Herodotus, and Roman historians such as Pliny the Elder and Diodorus. So I'm also going to show you guys some other stuff about the Greeks and the Greek mythologies when we get down the line. There are some stories you guys have heard that you guys call Greek mythology, when in reality they are not Greek mythology. They're actually African in origin. And when I say African, I mean the continent, not Hamites. When I use the term African on here, I'm talking about the continent. If I'm talking about the people, I try my best to say Hamite. Just so there's no confusion for the new people here, and even some of the people who've been here for a while. It is unclear when the Kedarites ceased to exist as a separately defined confederation of people, allies with the Nabataeans It is likely that they were absorbed into the Nabataean state around the 2nd century BCE. In Islam, Ismail is considered to be the ancestral forefather of the Arab people. And I guess that's Ishmael. I may be wrong. And in traditional Islamic historiography or historiography, Muslim historians have assigned great importance to their accounts of his first two sons, Nabioth and Kedar, with the genealogy of the Islamic prophet Muhammad alternately assigned to one or the other son, depending on the scholar. So this is where you will see the claim that the Arabs are descended from Ishmael through either Nabioth, you guys know I'm horrible with names, especially names in other languages, and Kedar. So now we're going to get into the Nabataeans. We'll call them the Nabataeans. And so they believe on here, according to Wikipedia, that the Kedarites were absorbed into the Nabataeans. So let's look at the Nabataeans real briefly. So now we're talking about Arabia. And the reason I'm talking about Arabia is because we've been fed this narrative that no black people have Middle Eastern DNA. We aren't linked to the Middle East at all. And I'm not saying that all black people descend from Kedar. I'm not saying that all black people are Hamites or that all black people are Shemites through Israel. I'm not saying that either. I'm saying that there were all types of black people in the Middle East and that the Middle East was almost 100% black until we get up to Alexander the Great and some of the other stuff and we start to see mixing. Well, not even then. After centuries of mixing, then you're going to start to see a shift. And then later on, we get into the Arab invasions around 600 AD. We're going to talk about that too and how the color of the Middle East changed. And remember, Middle East, when we say Middle East, we're talking about these areas right here that they try to separate from the rest of the world. This green part was considered Africa, especially this part right here. Now, some people are, you know, not consistent on whether Iran was or not, but definitely all of Arabia was connected to this as one name. I would say it's physically connected, but as one name, considered African territory. And again, this is going to be considered North Africa. They try to separate all this. Why? Because a lot of this stuff has to do with the Bible's narrative of where Israel is, and they want to separate Israel's involvement from anything African. So they leave this stuff alone, the Hamite part right here. They blur the line on Egypt, even though the Bible calls Egypt the land of Ham. They tell you this is Hamite territory. This is Hamite territory. Hamite territory stretched all up in here, but they leave that part out. And I have a good feeling that the documentary is going to do the same. Kedarites. All right. So the Kedarite kingdom, Nabataeans. That's what we're moving on to. The Nabataeans, also Nabataeans, were an ancient Arab people who inhabited northern Arabia and in southern Levant. Their settlements, most prominently the assumed capital of Rakhmu, present-day Petra, Jordan, gave the name Nabataean. Ancient Greek Nabataean to the Arabian borderland that stretched from the Euphrates to the Red Sea. So let's see if we have another map over here. Let's see if we got a bigger map. Can't enlarge that. Did I close down the other one? Let me see. Nope, that ain't the map I want to use there. Here we go. So the Euphrates to the Red Sea. So basically over in this area, from the Euphrates to here, that's going to be the Nabataeans. All right. So I was right there at the map, and they have a map right here, but it cuts off over here. But yeah, you're on the Red Sea. So basically from here to here somewhere. All right. So yeah, basically from over this way to over here. This is where the Nabataeans are going to be. Let me go back. The Nabataeans were one of several nomadic Bedouin tribes that roamed the Arabian desert in search of pasture and water for their herds. They emerged as a distinct civilization and political entity between the 4th and 2nd centuries BC, with their kingdom centered around a loosely controlled trading network that brought considerable wealth and influence across the ancient world. Now remember, they're going to be descendants of Abraham as well. Described as fiercely independent by contemporary Greco-Roman accounts, the Nabataeans were annexed into the Roman Empire by Emperor Trajan in 106 CE or AD. Nabataeans' individual culture, easily identified by their characteristic finely potted painted ceramics, was adopted into the larger Greco-Roman culture. So they just came in and appropriated this culture. Again, the Greco-Roman Empire is linked to America. If you look at the fall of the Greco-Roman Empire, they're going to break into Britain and some of these other Europeans. And then it is the descendants of the British, the English, that come over here to America and found America. But it just tells you right here, they adopted into the larger culture. They later converted to Christianity during the late Roman era. Jane Tara describes them as one of the most gifted peoples of the ancient world. So right here, origin, we'll read just this first paragraph. And this is Petra down here. Some of you guys will recognize this from some of the Nephilim studies and, you know, some of the other stuff we've talked about. The Nabataeans were among several nomadic tribes who roamed the Arabian desert, moving with their herds to wherever they could find pasture and water. These nomads became familiar with their area as seasons passed, and they struggled to survive during bad years when seasonal rainfall diminished. Although the Nabataeans were initially embedded in the Aramaic culture, modern scholars reject theories about their having Aramaean roots. Historical, religious, and linguistic evidence identifies them as a northern Arabian tribe. We'll come down here. The Nabataeans have been identified with Nebaoth of the Hebrew Bible, the descendants of Ishmael, Abraham's son. So again, I encourage y'all to vet anything we read on Wikipedia. Now, don't just accept it because Dante said it. All right. So now we're gonna check this reference out. Among the unknown tribes of South Arabia, this is by Bertram Thomas. This is published in 1929, a journal of the Royal Anthropological Institute of Great Britain and Ireland. And I'm not even going to read stuff. Well, a lot of stuff. I'm going to show you a few things. This is what I'm going to do. I'm going to show you a few things, mostly pictures. I'm only going to read a little bit. All right, we're going to read this first page. And then I'm going to show you what he found. This is, again, among some unknown tribes of South Arabia, Bertram Thomas, the Journal of the Royal Anthropological Institute of Great Britain and Ireland. This is from 1929. Among some unknown tribes of South Arabia. From a point of view of exploration, South Arabia is divided by the line of longitude 55 east. What little exploration has been done by Europeans is to be placed west of that line. Eastward, no European has at any time before penetrated the hinterland, except for a small journey made in the Jaalin by Lieutenant Wellsted more than 100 years ago, so around 1829. Southeastern Arabia has thus remained terra incognita, and its map a blank. Commercial intercourse with South Arabia, chiefly in connection with frankincense, was carried on probably by the Greeks and certainly later by the Romans, and this led to a knowledge of local geography, which has been preserved for us by Ptolemy, Pliny, Dionysius, and others. But that intercourse was of necessity confined to the western half of the south coast, and we turn in vain to the classical geographers for any considerable light on the eastern half of the southern littoral. The Arab geographers add little, and that except for Ibn Battuta, when he speaks of Dafar on the evidence of others, the truth would seem to be that sterility and barbarism, the two chief characteristics of the southeastern borderland of Ruba and Kali, have throughout the ages been prohibitive alike to Europeans and to Arabs. Interesting. We'll keep reading the rest of this. In January and February of 1928, I accomplished a journey through the country in which no European had previously set foot. So now we're going to hear some more explorers' tales. Go watch part one, and I talk about the importance of explorers' tales. This guy claims to be an eyewitness, firsthand eyewitness to what he's writing about. He says in 1928, he accomplished the journey. So he is a primary source here. 15 camels and an escort of 12 Arabs, a changing personnel except for three guides, constituted my caravan. And the journey of 650 miles from Suez to Dafar occupied 48 days. This included two halts, one of 7 days at Calaf and the other of 3 days at the entrance of Wadi Anain, made for the purpose of changing camels, and this in effect divided the journey into three approximate equal stages. I should say at the outset that I traveled under no government auspices. In fact, no auspices but my own, and the success of the journey depended upon my living as a Badu and mixing freely with the natives and being passed from sheikh to sheikh. It is country that owes allegiance to no government, and where every man goes armed, and three times my innocent caravan came under hostile fire for no better reason than that we were mistaken for raiders with whom it would be suicidal to do other than shoot first and inquire afterwards. So he's saying where he went, everybody was armed and they got shot at three times because people mistook them for raiders. All right. So now we have an understanding of who we're talking about, where we're talking about, and what we're about to see. Now, again, if we're talking about historical consistency here, and so far the history points to people being black, dark skin, very dark, dark ones, we should expect that his journey would be consistent with us if we are not lying. If the other people are telling the truth, well, in 1929, if Arabia looked as we're being presented with it in the mass media, then this man who traveled to Arabia should also bring back consistent images because he took pictures. It should be images consistent with a white or lighter skinned Arabia. And again, we're talking about, let me pull the image again. We're talking about this big chunk of continent where we have a bunch of light-skinned people running around saying they're Arabs, which I'm not saying it's not true because Arab or Arabian refers to the geography. And we are rarely presented. I'm just playing with the mouse now. We're rarely presented with a dark Arabia. So now let me jump to page. Let's start. No, not page 18, but page 18 I want to show you. But I'm going to jump to around that area. All right, so actually page 15. So now we're on page 14 right now. And he's going to show you members of his caravan and other people he ran into on page 15 and I think 15 through 18. So we're going to look and we're going to see what these people look like. We're going to look. The author's three companions, the Badawin of Janaba tribe and a Badu of Yao Waba. Now, I'm no expert. I'm just a amateur historian enthusiast that likes to dig through history. But these do not look like dark-skinned Caucasians to me. These do not look like tanned Caucasians. These are dark people. But this is what we should expect to find if Shem was dark and Elam was dark and they passed on this darkness through their family. And then the Hamites are dark and they pass this on to Hagar. And then Hagar and Abraham get together and they have a son named Ishmael. So chances are he was dark. And then when Ishmael married, chances are he married a dark woman. And then they had a dark child named Kedar. And then we kept seeing that the Kedarites, the Nabataeans, all these descendants of Abraham were referred to as Arabs. And now we have a journey in 1929 accomplished by a European. And this is the pictures he takes. So let's look. He got some more pictures. These are not tanned Europeans. These are not tanned European Sahara tribesmen. Kara, tribesmen among Samoan, that's the title of the book. These are not dark-skinned Europeans. These guys are a little bit lighter skinned, but you know, we come in all shades. Tribesmen at entrance of the cave above Duration Kara Mountains. Duratum Kara Mountains. These guys are not super light. You can still tell these are dark people. The Emir of Bani Bu Ali tribe, probably the Blule of Ptolemy's map. Let's see if we got any more. Can't really see anybody on this picture. See a person here, but you can't really tell. You can tell he's not a white person, though. Oh, and then we have here the shrine at Kubakum. Let's see, Hamrum, 15th or 16th century. Ruins near Angat showing typical columns. And you see these people here. I'm just saying. The images that he brought back don't reflect the reality that we see in the mainstream media now. The stuff we're talking about doesn't reflect the reality of the mainstream media. But let's keep going. So now, let's talk about Isaac real quick. So Isaac is born to Sarah. And remember, Isaac is born to Sarah, and Isaac is going to go choose Rebekah. But let's read some of this. And Abraham was old and stricken in age, and the Lord had blessed Abraham in all things. And Abraham said unto his eldest servants of his house that ruled over all he had, put, I pray thee, thy hand under my thigh, and I will make thee swear by the Lord, the God of heaven and the God of the earth, that thou shalt not take a wife unto my son of the daughters of the Canaanites among whom I dwell. So he didn't want these Hamite descendants to be married to Isaac, specifically the Canaanites. Because remember, Abraham had a child by an Egyptian woman, so it wasn't that he was against all Hamites. He didn't want these specific Hamites to be married to his son. But thou shalt go unto my country and unto my kindred and take a wife unto my son Isaac. And the servant said unto him, peradventure the woman will not be willing to follow me unto this land. Must I needs bring thy son again unto the land from whence thou came? So if she won't follow me here, should I take him there? And Abraham said unto him, beware that thou bring not my son thither again. So don't take my son there, bring her here. And the Lord God of heaven, which took me from my father's house and from the land of my kindred, and which spake unto me, and that sware to me, saying, unto thy seed will I give this land, he shall send his angel before thee, and thou shalt take a wife unto my son from thence. And if the woman will not be willing to follow thee, then thou shalt be clear from this my oath, only bring not my son thither again. So let's keep going. And the servant put his hand under the thigh of Abraham, his master, and swore unto him concerning that matter. And the servant took 10 camels and camels of his master and departed, for all the goods of his master were in his hand. And he arose and went to Mesopotamia unto the city of Nahor. He went to Mesopotamia. Hold on real quick. I want to get you guys a map. All right. So we pulled up a Mesopotamia map. So Mesopotamia is going to be this area right here. Doesn't this look similar to where Hamites settled? All I'm saying is there's a consistency here. They go to Mesopotamia. So let's continue reading. Unto the city of Nahor, and he made his camels to kneel down without the city by a well of water at the same time in the evening, even the time when the women go out to draw water. And he said, O Lord God of my master Abraham, I pray thee send me good speed this day and show kindness unto my master Abraham. And behold, I stand here by the well of water, and the daughters of the men of the city come out to draw water. And let it come to pass that the damsel whom I say, to whom I shall say, let down thy pitcher, I pray thee, that I may drink, she shall say, drink, and I will give thy camels drink also. Let the same be she that thou hast appointed for my servant Isaac, and thereby shall I know, or for thy servant Isaac, not mine, thy servant Isaac, and thereby shall I know that thou hast showed kindness unto my master. And so now he's going to choose Rebekah. And so let's see how far down we want to go. Right here. And he said, "Blessed be the Lord God of my master Abraham, who hath not left destitute my master of his mercy and his truth. I being in the way, the Lord led me to the house of my master's brethren. And the damsel ran and told them of her mother's house these things. And Rebekah had a brother, and his name was Laban. And Laban ran out unto the man, unto the well." So now Rebekah is Laban's sister. This is going to become important because, as we talked about before, Laban is a Syrian. Let's see here. Give me one second. I'm actually getting just a little bit ahead of myself. Let me. But anyway, Laban is a Syrian. Not a Syrian, but a Syrian. So now we covered Genesis 25. Let's go to Genesis 27. So now we get to Jacob. So Isaac marries Rebekah. And then Isaac and Rebekah, they're going to have Jacob and Esau. We're not going to touch on Esau right now. We're going to come back to Esau in the next part. We're going to focus on Jacob right now. And then I'm going to show you guys some documentation about Arabia, a few pictures about, you know, showing more what we've been saying about Arabia. So now after Jacob gets the blessing and the birthright and all that, right here, Isaac is, you know, talking to Esau. Let's just we'll go right here. Genesis 27-39. And Isaac his father answered and said unto him, "Behold, thy dwelling shall be the fatness of the earth and of the dew of heaven from above. And by the sword shall thou live and shall serve thy brother. And it shall come to pass, when thou shalt have the dominion, that thou shalt break his yoke from off thy neck." And Esau hated Jacob because of the blessing wherewith his father blessed him. And Esau said in his heart, "The days of mourning for my father are at hand. Then will I slay my brother Jacob." And these words Esau, her elder son, were told to Rebekah. And she sent and called Jacob, her younger son, and said unto him, "Behold, thy brother Esau, as touching thee, doth comfort himself, purposing to kill thee." Purposing to kill thee. "Now, therefore, my son, obey my voice and arise and flee to Laban, my brother, to Haran." So she's sending him back to Mesopotamia. "And tarry with him a few days until thy brother Fury turn away." And we know this turned into 14 years at minimum. Until thy brother's anger turn away from thee, and he forget that which thou hast done to him. Then I will send and fetch thee from thence. Why should I be deprived also of you both in one day?" And Rebekah said to Isaac, "I am weary for my life because of the daughters of Heth, of the Hittites. If Jacob take a wife of the daughters of Heth, such as these which are of the daughters of the land, what good shall my life do me?" So Abraham didn't want Isaac to marry any Canaanites, and Rebekah didn't want Jacob to marry any Hittites. And we're going to see that Esau does marry Hittites or Hamites. And when we get into Esau, we're going to talk about some stuff that some people don't want to talk about, which is why I personally don't say that Esau is the white man. Esau married among several nations. So anyway, back to Jacob. So he flees from Esau. Oh, and one correction I do want to make, because sometimes when I'm in the moment talking about this stuff, I don't catch misspeaks or mistakes I made while I'm talking. Sometimes I do. In part one, I mentioned that I believe it was the Cape of Africa, that is towards South Africa. And I think I mentioned it in connection with West Africa. So I did want to make that connection. So sometimes I be confusing terms because I'm not 100% as familiar with Africa as I want to be in the boundary lines and stuff like that. So yeah, sometimes misspeaks occur, but that happens. So if you guys have listened to part one and you question that's a quick correction right there. So now Jacob is fleeing. So now Jacob is going to basically flee to Laban. Let me see something real quick. All right, just a real quick detour. So Rebecca was the daughter of Bethuel the Syrian, and she was the sister of Laban the Syrian. We went over that, and then it's mentioned again in chapter 28, where Laban is called the son of Bethuel the Syrian, the brother of Rebecca. And if we go back real quick and look at this map, you're going to have Israel here, and you're going to have Syria in this general area, where both Shem and Ham's descendants are said to be dark. And then let me show you the full map. Like I said, this is Syria right here. So they're among dark people. So now Jacob is going to flee. He's going to end up being tricked into Laban's treachery. So Leah's the older, and he knows that Jacob is in love with his younger daughter, Rachel. So he tricks Jacob into marrying Leah first. And then Jacob works another 7 years and he gets Rachel. So in this, we have a term, a week of years. This is where we come to the term week of years, which is where they're going to come up with the doctrine of interpreting Daniel's 70 weeks as 70 weeks of years, or 490 years. So just understand where that comes from. Right here is in Genesis 29, 27. Let's see. We'll start 26 and go through 30. 26 to 30. And Laban said, "It must not be done so in our country to give the younger before the firstborn. Fulfill her week, and we will give thee this also for the service which thou shalt serve me. Serve with me yet 7 other years. So when he said fulfill her week, he meant a week of 7 years. And Jacob did so and fulfilled her week, and he gave him Rachel, his daughter, to wife also. So basically he married his cousins, two of his cousins, his Rachel and Leah. And his uncle was fine with that. And Laban gave to Rachel, his daughter, Bilhah, his handmaid, to be her maid. And so later on, Jacob is also going to have kids with Bilhah and Zilpah. And he went in also unto Rachel, and he loved also Rachel more than Leah, and served him yet 7 other years. So now 21 years, this done turned into 21 years. Remember, the mother sent him away to you know, hide away for a few days. He's been gone 21 years. And when the Lord saw that Leah was hated, he opened her womb, but Rachel was barren. So yeah, it gets into that, and it's gonna, you're gonna see the birth of the 12 tribes of Israel, which we're not gonna get into. But remember, Laban was a Syrian. A Syrian, not a Syrian. Laban was Syrian, which means Rachel and Leah were Syrians. And let's, in case we need a reminder, Harry Johnston, the Elamites of Mesopotamia appear to have been a Negroid people. So remember, they sent them to Mesopotamia to get wives. And in Mesopotamia, you have the Elamites, who are Negroid people with kinky hair, and to have transmitted this racial type to the Jews and Syrians. There's a curliness of the hair together with the Negro eye and full lips in portraiture of Assyria, which conveys the idea of an evident Negro element in Babylonia. Quite probably the very ancient Negro invasion of the Mediterranean, of Mediterranean Europe, of which the skeletons of the Alps, Maritimes, and vestiges came from Syria and Asia Minor on its way to Central and Western Europe. It is possible that in or on the verge of Arabia, the areas we're talking about, the ancient basal stock of the generalized Negro parted, divided into two great streams of divergent immigration, one to proceed to Europe via Syria, and the other to pass through Arabia to Egypt. So now they're saying the Negro strain passed through Syria. The basal stock of Negroes passed through to proceed to Europe via Syria. In Arabia and Egypt, it may be, arose the difference between the long-headed African Negro and the rounder, shorter-headed Bushman, the last name becoming more habituated than his congeners to a life in arid deserts or scrubby open country. And then we have this short reference right here, which is interesting. The Jews are composed of 3 or 4 separate racial elements. The Asiatic Negroid strain shows itself occasionally in the curly hair, the long eye, and the proportions of the skull. The Jewish hybrids with the Negro in Jamaica and Guinea or Guyana reproduced most strikingly the Assyrian type. So now we have more historical references that they did pass through Syria. We have the reference to Negroes being in Mesopotamia. We seen the older documents saying that Shem was dark, Ham was dark. Most people believe that Ham is black. We don't have to really convince a lot of people that Hamites are black. Most people just accept that. What they don't accept is that Shem was black or dark, even though we see through Abraham producing a child with Hagar, the son of that produced a son, or so Abraham's grandson is called a dark one or dark, and it refers to his skin color. We could just keep following this. Isaac, Abraham's servant was sent to Mesopotamia to get a wife for Isaac in the Syrian area. And we know that Rebecca was the sister of Laban, the Syrian. And we've seen that Harry Johnson said the Elamites were a Negroid people that passed on that racial type to the Jews and to the Syrians. Well, if you have it passed on to the Jews and the Syrians, and the Jews come from Isaac, and again, we know that the Israelites, I'm using the word Jew and Israelite interchangeably, and I know they come from Jacob. But when you read about it, Isaac took a Syrian wife. He's from the lineage that's going to lead to Israel. And then Jacob, Israel, took two Syrian women, Leah and Rachel. We're not told what Bilhah and Zilpah are in the Bible, but we know that Leah and Rachel are Syrian women. So if the Elamites passed down the Negroid, let me read this one more time for y'all, because we're going to put all this together. We're not going to skip over any of this like that documentary no doubtly will. The Elamites of Mesopotamia appear to have been a Negroid people with kinky hair and to have transmitted this racial type to the Jews and Syrians. So now, if they've transmitted that type to the Jews and Syrians, when he says Jews here, he's talking about Israelites. We know this. So if he's talking about the Jews and the Syrians inheriting a Negroid racial type, what would their offspring look like? Let's keep going. So now, we can make sense of things. So if these are Negroid people, now we can understand why they keep moving back and forth into Africa. Egypt specifically, but in Africa. And right here, when Jacob is told to move to Egypt, we're going to read this right here. Joseph has already been sold into Egypt as a slave. Joseph has already been given a Hamite wife by the name of Aseneth. And it's through Aseneth that we're going to see Ephraim and Manasseh come. We're not going to get into the 12 tribes now, but Ephraim and Manasseh were the children of a Hamite woman, Aseneth. She was Egyptian, and Egyptians come from Mizraim. Mizraim is one of the sons of Ham, whom we are told is the origin of black people, which is why they call us Hamites. So now, if Aseneth is a Hamite, and we accept the Hamites as black people, why then when we start talking about the Bible, a lot of people try to blur the line to say Egypt could look like anybody. It doesn't mean she was black because she was in Egypt. Well, the Bible calls this the land of Ham, and you told me Ham was black, so this would be land of the black people in the Bible. Well, that don't mean she's black. See, there is a cognitive dissonance that occurs with a lot of this narrative that we are forced to accept. And then when we come out of it, they get mad that we call them liars. And now they want to talk about history. Well, no, you should have been talking about history from day one. You should have been deceiving me with this false history. You should have been telling me that all these sources exist. But now they want to review the sources. They had a chance to review the sources. And again, the sources will be there for anybody to review on the links page. Genesis 46:1. Jacob, who is descended from a Syrian and an Israelite, both of which are said to have inherited their Negro racial types from the Elamites. Women who came from the Mesopotamia area, and we just read that there was Negro stock in Mesopotamia. And Israel took his journey with all that he had, and he came to Beersheba and offered sacrifices unto God, the God of his father Isaac. And God spake unto Israel in the visions of the night and said, Jacob, Jacob. And he said, here am I. And he said, I am God, the God of thy father. Fear not to go down into Egypt or Africa, for I will there in Africa or Egypt make thee a great nation. So God tells him to go to Africa. I'm going to make you a great nation in Africa. Now, if the documentary doesn't tell you that, if you hear these preachers out here talking and they don't tell you that when they start talking about Israel becoming a nation, ask them why they're not emphasizing the fact that God told Israel to go into Africa and that's where he was going to make them a nation. Why don't they emphasize Genesis 15, where the boundary lines set were from the Nile River in Africa to the Euphrates in what we call the modern day Middle East? They don't emphasize this African portion of the text. I will go down with thee into Egypt or Africa, and I will also surely bring thee up again, and Joseph shall put his hand upon thine eyes. And Jacob rose up from Beersheba, and the sons of Israel carried Jacob their father and their little ones and their wives in the wagons which Pharaoh had sent to carry him. So they weren't taken as slaves on ships into Egypt here. They went in as welcomed guests because of Joseph. And they took their cattle and their goods, which they had gotten in the land of Canaan, aka Hamite territory, and came into Egypt, aka Africa, aka the land of Ham. Jacob and all his seed with him, his sons and his sons' sons with him, his daughters and his sons' daughters, and all his seed brought he with him into Egypt. And these are the names of the children of Israel, which came into Egypt, Jacob and his sons, Reuben, Jacob's firstborn. We're not going to get into all these right now, but I want to go down here. Let me see. Right here. These are the sons. Right here. All the souls that came with Jacob into Egypt, Africa, which came out of his loins, besides Jacob's sons' wives, all the souls were 66. 76. And the sons of Joseph, which were born him in Egypt, Africa, were 2 souls. All the souls of the house of Jacob, which came into Egypt, were 70. 80. So we're going to stop there when it comes to the bloodline. Now, let's look at some pictures. Give me 1 second here. All right, before we get into all the pictures, we're gonna get into some, we're gonna get a little bit of history, a little bit of pictures. So this is the Christian Ladies Magazine, volume 28, R.B. Seeley and W. Burnside, 1848, Christian Life. So we're gonna look at this one first. And Christian Ladies Magazine, we're gonna read up here. We'll talk a little bit about Arabia. And let's just see how many people are giving you this history. And if they're not giving you the history, ask yourself, are they trying to stop you from looking into history? And why didn't they try to stop you from looking into history before when it has to do with the church fathers and everybody else? Why is it when it comes to black history, we are discouraged from looking at the history? When it comes to talking about the Bible, they want to talk about Jericho was discovered and, you know, all these other biblical places. But when we start talking about the people of the Bible, they want us to shut up about that. We're making it about skin color. Truth matters. So right here, we'll start right here. We find from Jeremiah 13:23 that the Cushites were black. We know that their African descendants are so at the present time. But it is perhaps not so generally known that a tribe of the Bedouins, they spelled it different, the Bedouins, did we just read that they were Ishmaelites? And that Ishmael had a black son? That the Bedouins, that a tribe of Bedouins called the Dawasir Arabs found in the land of Omar are also black. Oh, look, we're getting some historical consistency here. Their gigantic forms and sable features distinguish them from their Shemite neighbors and point them out as most likely the Sabians, men of stature, destined at some future day to swell the triumphs of Israel. We know not when the Cushite immigration to Africa took place. Probably it was continually going forward from the earliest period. Well, isn't that what we read in Genesis? We know, however, that in the time of Moses, African Ethiopia had risen to an important kingdom. For we learn from Josephus that Moses, as Pharaoh's general, defeated the Ethiopians and drove them to Meroe. We know also that the Ethiopians worshipped Ammon. He's mentioned in the Bible, that their government was in the hands of the priest, and that they were alternately conquerors of and conquered by Egypt. Now, having, as we hope, proved that Cush was an Asiatic as well as an African power, it remains to be considered to which of these countries the Holy Scriptures allude. And here we may lay down one very simple rule for the guidance of the young student of Scripture, that when either in history or prophecy Cush is spoken of in connection with Egypt or Libya, as in Ezekiel 30 verse 5, African Ethiopia or Abyssinia is allied to, but where it is mentioned with Midian or other Arabian tribes, then Asiatic Ethiopia or Arabia is intended. Wait a minute, Asiatic Ethiopia? Cushites are black. Thus we find in Zephaniah 3:10 that the Jews are to be brought from beyond the rivers of Cush. From Genesis 2, we find the names of these rivers, and from Revelation 16:12, we learn that the Euphrates, the chief of them, is to be dried up for a triumphant march of the kings of the east. Fearing to make my chapter too long, I must reserve what more is to be gathered from Scripture as to the future destiny of Cush till I come to treat in another chapter of his son Rama and his children. So anyway, they're talking about Ethiopian Arabia, Asiatic Ethiopia. Let's just keep going. That link will be in the description. Let's look at the Encyclopedia Britannica. This is from 1910, a Dictionary of Arts, Science, Literature, General Information, Volume 7, the Encyclopedia Britannica. We're going to read on Cush right here. Let me see if I can make it bigger without getting it too distorted. Cush, the eldest son of Ham in the Bible, from whom seems to have been derived the name of the land of Cush, commonly rendered Ethiopia, by the Septuagint and by the Vulgate. So Septuagint predates the King James. You often hear it called the LXX, which stands for 70, which is what Septuagint means. And then you have the Vulgate or the Vulgata Sacra, which is what the Catholics use. And it's written in Latin. The locality of the land of Cush has long been a much vexed question. Bochart maintained that it was exclusively in Arabia. And now remember, they will tell you that black people don't have any ties to the Middle East. Now they're discussing whether Cush is in Arabia. We're reading two different sources here. Schultz and Jessenius held that it should be sought for nowhere but in Africa, see Ethiopia. Others again, like Michaelis and Rosenmuller, have supposed that the name Cush was applied to the tracts of country both in Arabia and in Africa. But the defective condition of the ancient knowledge of countries and peoples, as also the probability of early migrations of Cushite tribes carrying with them their name, will account for the main facts. The existence of an African Cush cannot reasonably be questioned. Though the term employed in the Old Testament with some latitude, the African Cush covers Upper Egypt and extends southward from the first cataract, that the term was also applied to parts of Arabia is evident from Genesis 10:7, where Cush is the father of certain tribal and ethnical designations, all of which point very clearly to Arabia, with the very doubtful exception of Seba, which Josephus identifies as Meroe. Even in the 5th century AD, the Himyarites in the south of Arabia were styled by Syrian writers Cushian or Ethiopians, or Cushian and Ethiopians. Moreover, the Babylonian inscriptions mention the Kashi, or the Kashi, I'm not even going to try to pronounce SH twice, an Elamite race whose name has been equated with the classical, that's in Greek, and it has been held that this affords a more appropriate explanation of Kush, perhaps rather Cash, the ancestor of the Babylonian Nimrod. Although decisive evidence is lacking, it seems extremely probable that several references to Cush in the Old Testament cannot refer to Ethiopia, despite the likelihood that considerable confusion existed in the minds of early writers. The Cushite invasion in 2 Chronicles 14, see Asa, is intelligible if the historical foundation for the story be a raid by Arabians. But in 16:8, the inclusion of Libyan shows that the enemy was subsequently supposed to be African. In several passages, the interpretation is bound up with that of Mizraim and depends in general upon the questions of whether Ethiopia at the given time enjoyed the prominence given to it. So they're saying that they use this word Cush to refer to Mizraim or Egyptians. It referred to Upper Egypt. It referred to parts of Arabia. And it also referred to Libyans sometimes. Let me go back up. This is why we have Ham all over here. They use that word Cush interchangeably, according to the source. And the Cushites were in Arabia, according to those sources. According to three different sources I showed you, the Christian Woman's Magazine, the one I just read now, and the Harry Johnston source, the Negro in the New World. So we see that this is, we see that this is common. It was common knowledge that there were black people all over Arabia, black people in Africa. And yet somehow the narrative we've been fed is that Israel mixed with these people for hundreds of years, thousands of years, all the way back to Abraham, probably before. But at least back to Abraham, according to the Bible, they mixed with the people in these areas and they look like these other people over there today. Hold on. They're telling us that after all this mixing, so the narrative that they give us is that Israel mixed in with the nations and they look like this. Now they look like this. Now they don't look like anything like what they started out as. This is what they look like now. Because they've mixed to the point that they no longer look like Negroes. Even though historically we've seen that. So now ask yourself, we've been in this country for 400 years. Do we have any Negroes that, I'm talking about a bunch of them, like a whole nation of them, that don't look anything like their ancestors at all? Even the mixed ones we can tell are us. We can tell when mixed people are still us. We're not confused by that. We can tell the difference. I'm not even letting me get that. I'm just saying. Now, I'm not going to say that none of these people are, because as I've told y'all before, I've come across evidence that seems to point to the direction that some of the Khazars lived with the Sun Black tribe of Manasseh, and some of them mixed with the Sun Black tribe of Manasseh, but not all of them, some, because it was looked down upon to mix with these other people. And so I'm talking about on both sides, not just from Israel, but the other side too. They all looked down upon mixing. You will find that among the Jerusalem Jews and the ancient Jews when you get into Cochin India and Claudius Buchanan. You will see that neither groups wanted to mix with each other. You will see that the same thing happens with the Spanish and Sephardic Jews. They didn't want to mix with other people, but it did happen. Occasionally somebody went out and mixed. But they're claiming that Israel mixed and mixed and mixed and then created a whole new nation of people visually. They went from being Negro, like Harry Johnson described, to this. This is the narrative we're given. But let's keep going. Let's look at the prophet promised in world scriptures. This book right here was written in 2013, but I want to show you is written by someone who don't look nothing like us. I guess he's a Muslim based on what I've read, based on his name. Now, this is the other name. I don't know exactly if he's any of these guys or which of these guys he is, but I Googled the name. I didn't think it was a common name, but apparently this name is more common than I thought. But anyway, I don't know which of these people had to do with it. But as you notice, nobody that looks like an Israelite comes up. No black people, no African-Americans, no nothing. These are all the search results on this name. None of them look like me. So now I'm going to read a little bit about this. Just a little bit. Let's see. We'll read down to about here. This small print. All right. Isaiah 6 prophecy, the oracle concerning Arabia. The oracle concerning Arabia. Let me see if I can zoom in. There we go. The oracle concerning Arabia is the thickest in Arabia shall you lodge. In the thickest in Arabia shall you lodge, O you caravan of Dedanites. To him that was thirsty, they brought water. The inhabitants of the land of Temah did meet the fugitive with their bread. For they fled away from the swords and from the drawn sword and from the bent bow and from the grievousness of war. For thus has the Lord said to me, within a year, according to the years of a hireling, all the glory of Kedar shall fail. And the residue of the number of the archers, the mighty men of the children of Kedar, shall be few. For the Lord, the God of Israel, has spoken it. The oracle concerning Arabia. The first sentence of this prophecy has direct connections with Arabia. This is what we're talking about, historical consistency. The county where the holy prophet was born and carried out his mission. He's talking about Muhammad. Oracle means, I think it's talking about Muhammad right here, because I believe this is a Muslim. When they say the holy prophet, they're usually referring to Muhammad. I don't think he's talking about Isaiah. Where the holy prophet was born and carried out his mission. Oracle means one who is believed to have communicated with God and gives advice to people or the message given by an oracle. Therefore, in its first sentence, the prophecy speaks of one who would appear in Arabia and convey a message to people from God. Banu Oz and Banu, I'm not going to try to butcher all these words. It says the second sign in the prophecy is contained in the sentence, the thickest in Arabia, in the thickest of Arabia will you lodge, O caravan of Dedanites. Dedan was a grandson of Cush, a son of Ham and grandson of Noah. Cush was also the name of a region. Scholars like Johann Michaelis and Rosemuller, didn't we just read those names in the source, have pointed out that the name Cush was applied to the tracts of country on both sides of the Red Sea in Arabia, Yemen, and in Africa. These are things I mentioned, and now they're mentioning them. And again, this is from 2013. In the 5th century AD, the Hamorites in the south of Arabia were called Cushians and Ethiopians by Syrian writers. Arabia is known as the Eastern Cush, and Ethiopian Africa is Western Cush. This southern part of Arabia was usually fertile and lush and therefore called Arabia Felix or Happy Arabia by geographers. Caravans of Dedanites referred to by Isaiah were the Banu Oz and Banu Khazaraj, children of the Oz, children of Kajara. Yeah, I hope I pronounced that. Kadra. The two of the clans who inhabited Yemen. We're going to talk about Yemenite Jews in a second. Let me see. We're not going to read all the way down. I don't want to get into Sheba too much just yet, but I'm going to read this last paragraph. The people of Sheba ruled in southern Arabia for almost 1,000 years from around 1100 BC to 115 BC. Their capital was Ma'arib. They controlled the trade between East Asia, India, and Far East, and Arabia with Egypt, Syria, Greece, and Rome. In addition to this, they had an excellent irrigation system that dotted the length and breadth of the country with dams. Between their unusually fertile and lush lands and Syria, there were cities that were located near each other, and travelers could travel in this vast area in security, as understood from the relationship between Prophet Solomon, upon him be peace, and the Queen of Sheba. We'll get into that later, too, in his time. What's going to happen is you're going to have Solomon, who's the Queen of Sheba, is going to come visit Solomon, and then common sense tell you they hooked up. But whether or not a kid was produced, that's left out of the Bible. But when you get into other history, you're going to see Queen Makeda or Makeda has a son. And we're going to get into their son later on. But anyway, their son comes back, and then there's an Ark of a Covenant, whole thing. I don't want to get ahead of myself and start talking about the son just yet. All right, the divine religion found a way to their land, although they had previously worshipped the sun. However, they went astray later, and their prosperous life drove them to sins without repentance. They did not give heed to the warnings made to them. In the end, they deserved a severe punishment. The dams and the irrigation systems collapsed, and their cities and fertile lands were overwhelmed by floods and changed into wastelands. The people were scattered throughout Arabia in small groups, and the civilization of Sheba came to exist only in the tales that circulated among people. So Sheba, descendant of Ham, was in Arabia. And right now, I'm not getting into these for the descendancy purpose. I'm just showing that there were Hamites all over Arabia. There were black Shemites all over Arabia. This is from 1880. Memorials of Gilbert Haven, Bishop of the Methodist Episcopal Church. One more time. Memorials of Gilbert Haven, Bishop of the Methodist Episcopal Church, 1880, January 1880. And again, all these links are going to be in the description. I know they like to say, well, Dante don't read the whole thing. I just want y'all to see. When they say Dante don't read the whole thing, there's a ton of this stuff. There's no way. We're not going to get through all this in one sitting. It just doesn't make sense. So you guys come here and read this for yourself. Links will be in the description. So let's get back to Gilbert. Let's get back to Gilbert. Where do we want to read from? I think we're going to read this. Yeah, I think we're going to read this. This is the notes. So this is not actual part of the, was part of the book, but what happened in these older books, as I've mentioned before, you will have the paragraphs here. This paragraph ends here and it picks up again here. This with the star next to it is a note or notes. And you read these separate from this. So let's see. We're going to come back to some of this. It says, it is impossible, of course, to declare certainly the complexion of our Savior. We're talking about Christ. Our only guides are the people of the land where he lived. Some fancy he was a white man, but this could not be except in violation of every law of race. The natives of Palestine, Jews and Arabs, except for the few of the former imported from Germany. Wait a minute. They were imported from Germany. This is going to be important because later on, we're going to talk about German Jews in the Elbe and how they're fair skinned. So right here. In 1880, let me go back up. A bishop of the Methodist Episcopal Church, W.H. Daniels, 359 pages. We're not reading the whole source. The link will be there for you guys to read if you want to. He's saying that they were imported from Germany. So let's one more time. The natives of Palestine, Jews and Arabs, except the few of the former imported from Germany, are of a brown complexion, almost the color of the bright brown mulatto. The women of Nazareth, who still gather at the well of Annunciation, are of this dusky hue. The most beautiful lady we saw abroad, one of the loveliest we ever looked upon, was a brown Bethlehem Jewess, who passed us at the tomb of Rachel on her donkey with her brown bearded and turbaned lord and lover walking at her side, a perfect type of Rachel and Jacob of 4,000 years before. Just such complexions may one see today in those who were but lately Southern slaves. Let me back up again. Are they saying that we can find out the way Christ looked based on the way his people look? And he's saying that the Palestinian Jews and Arabs were brown. But wait, I don't want y'all to miss the point that in the late 1800s, 1880 is when this book was published. And there's a difference between when the book was published and how long it took to write. Published in 1880, they were already importing Germans into Palestine. We can't be lost on that fact. One more time. Just such complexions may one see today in those who were but lately Southern slaves, a very comely and attractive Bedouin of a bright brown complexion. So didn't we read that the Bedouins are descended from Ishmael? And we went through all this. Kedar, his son, Abraham's grandson, means black or dark. A very comely and attractive Bedouin of a bright brown complexion went up the pyramids with us and stood under the Sphinx. When asked to come to America, he replied, "You will sell me." We have been selling multitudes of his complexion for generations. Dean Stanley describes Abraham as a Bedouin sheikh, except in the faith, he says, in every aspect, the likeness is complete between the Bedouin chief of the present day and the Bedouin chief who came from Chaldea nearly 4,000 years ago. One of these aspects is complexion, and the Arab of Palestine and the wilderness is very like Frederick Douglass in this particular. Hold on. Let me pull up a picture of Frederick Douglass. All right, I went ahead and pulled up two pictures of Frederick Douglass. Here's one right here from The Guardian. Frederick Douglass. Here's Frederick Douglass. Frederick Douglass. And then I pulled this one up over here. This is from PBS. Frederick Douglass. So let me go back and read this one more time. One of these aspects is complexion. And the Arab of Palestine and the wilderness is very like Frederick Douglass in this particular. Abraham and his wife were both of the present wandering race. Isaac's wife was of his parents' Mesopotamia origin. This is what I just read to you guys. We're talking about historical consistency here. That came right out of the book. And so was Jacob's. Exactly what we went over. Joseph's was an Egyptian lady of color. Moses married an Ethiopian. Salmon, I don't know how they would choose to pronounce that. I say salmon, but that's the fish clearly. Salmon married the Canaanite Rahab. Boaz, the brown Moabitess beauty Ruth. We're going to get into some more of these as we go on. David's Bathsheba was a Hittite. And some people try to make Bathsheba an Israelite, but that's simply not true. We will go back and see that there were tribes left in the land. There were leagues made with people, agreements made with people that they wouldn't be wiped out. And Uriah, Bathsheba's husband, was a Hittite. And if you continue to read, you will see that the grandfather of Bathsheba was a Gihonite or a Gilonite, and they were considered to be part of the Hittite or Canaanite tribes. So Bathsheba was a Canaanite in general and very likely a Hittite specifically. She was a descendant of Ham. Both groups are descendant of Ham. Canaanites, Hittites, all these people in that area were descendants of Ham. And David and Bathsheba's union is going to lead to Solomon. So there's a historical consistency. What is not consistent, I'm going to show y'all what ain't consistent. This is not consistent with history. But as I said, it's not my teaching that none of these people are. Yeah, people who are clearly have something else going on. These two people don't look alike. These people. Now, I don't know what their origin is, but you could tell that some people have a darker tint to them. They have a darker hue to them. I don't know what his origin is. I don't know if he's would consider himself Jewish or not. But some of these people have a darker tint, and some of these people have a very, very light tint to them. These people don't always look alike. We're going to get into the Khazars and, you know, all that stuff. They try to make the Khazars out to be a myth. The myth of the Khazar conversion and the origin of Ashkenazi Jews. Well, as I've pointed out to y'all before, I found historical documents to say that the some black tribe of Manasseh lived among the Khazars, and some of them mixed, and we also see some conversions among that. It is not a myth. This is what they want to push in order to hold on to the fact that they are the people of the book. But let's keep going. We looked up Frederick Douglass. Let me read the rest of this, and then we're going to move on. Let me see. All right, Canaanite Rahab, Boaz the Brown, Moabitess Beauty Ruth, David's Bathsheba was a Hittite, a wild slip of the land, very comely, but as far from white as from black. Also, he doesn't believe that they were white or black. He believes they're right in between. Solomon had a swarthy daughter of Pharaoh to wife. The later marriages were no lighter. And undoubtedly, Mary was of the likeness as well as the lineage of David and Bathsheba and Ruth and Rahab and Rachel and Rebecca. So now, here's where they come into the problem. Is he named a lot of Hamites. He named a lot of Hamites, and Hamites are dark-skinned people. And yet, even now, trying to water it down, saying, oh, they're far from black as they were from white. Nah, not necessarily true. Jesus Christ stood midway between the complexions of man, that he might lay his hand upon both and blend both together in himself. See, these are politically correct ways of saying things. They want to believe that Jesus wouldn't come as black or white because him being black is divisive. But divisive to who? It's only divisive to racists. When we believed Jesus was white, we didn't care. We still believed in the Messiah. It wasn't about skin color with us. And now that we point out historically accurate sources that say, hey, these people were black and not what y'all told us they look like, now they want to say we're making it about race, but they don't want to talk about the fact that we believed in a white Jesus. We worshiped a white Jesus. For them, it's about race. This is why it's so divisive to them, not to us, to them. The Asiatic is the solvent of the Caucasian and the Negro, and his color is almost exactly reproduced in the mulatto of America, the amalgam of the two opposite complexions. A light-haired, light-skinned Italian or a dark-skinned German is far more natural than a light-skinned native of the hot climate, and these are extremely rare. Every Arab, wild or tame, is of one color, and that is almost exactly the hue of the mixed blood of America, whom we so foolishly and falsely profess to naturally abhor. They are the very complexion of the mother of our Lord, nay, of our Lord himself. So let's look up a mixed person. He said they look like mixed people of America. All right, so now I mistakenly typed in mulatto. I mistakenly typed in mulatto, and I'm glad I paused the video before I did, because there were a lot of pictures of the rapper, the female rapper, if y'all don't know. And yeah, some of them were definitely not appropriate for this channel. So can we tell, do we still call these black people? We're not confused. They put these pictures up as mulatto, and we know that's an offensive word, but we still call them black. We don't call these people mulattoes. We don't act like they're a separate race of people. We recognize our people. We know exactly what our people look like. Let me see what else we got over here. We know what our people look like. We know exactly. We could tell he has a darker tint to him. We could tell he's not 100% anything. This is Tracy Ellis Ross from Blackish. I cannot think of her name right now. We know what our people look like. There's no confusion. We know what J. Cole looks like. We know who these people are. Now, we're talking about skin color here in this particular moment. So now let's look up Arabs. Modern Arabs. We can tell this is not a Negro, even though they have a darker tint. See, they're playing games as if we can't tell the difference between some people, and we can look at certain people and we know what we're talking about, even though people don't want to admit it. They walk around, they know who's black and they know who's not black. They know who's just a dark-skinned Indian. We can tell when somebody's a dark Indian. Friend of mine, we were in the store, and this lady who was clearly an Indian, she walks up and says, us black people, we got to stick together. And I was like, I get what you're saying, but that context ain't right. We can tell he's not, let's say, African-American. Now, all of you African-Americans watching, we can tell when these people are of a different nation. Just because they have dark skin, we are not confused that they are not of our nation. When I say our nation, I mean descendants of slaves taken in the transatlantic slave trade. We wouldn't be confused by it. This guy right here might get a, he might. He most definitely might be Negro. He looks very, very close to our people. However, this lady right here, no. She wouldn't pass for Negro. These would not pass for Negroes. This man might. Let me see. He looks Australian. And when I say Australian, I mean Aborigine. Again, we can kind of tell. And people can say whatever they want to. We know what we're talking about. Whether people want to admit it or not, we know exactly what I'm talking about right now. Just because the skin is dark does not mean they would pass for us. We understand that there are certain characteristics that separate people from being other people, even when their skin color is exactly the same or similar. But anyway, let's keep going. So we talked about Frederick Douglass. We talked about some of that stuff. Now, this right here is from the Museum of Fine Arts, Boston. Let y'all look at him real quick. Y'all can see he's not a Caucasian. Y'all can see he's not a light-skinned Arab. Y'all can see that he's, I'm just gonna let y'all look. I ain't gonna say nothing. So let's see what this says. Tile with Philistine chief. So wait a minute, he's a Philistine? This is a Philistine? So wait, didn't David go out and fight the Philistines? Was David fighting people this color? Why aren't we showing that when we see these Bible movies or when people talk about David and Goliath? Why don't they show us these pictures? When is this from? Let's see when this is from. Let's read the description. This is this right here. Tile with Philistine chief, New Kingdom, Dynasty 20, reign of Ramses III, 1184 to 1153 BC. Fine spot, Egypt. Medinet Habu, Thebes, Luxor, Palace of Ramses III. This is where they found it. Faience Palace tile inlay depicting captive Philistine chief with elbows bound behind. Attributes include reddish skin, small pointed beard, white robe, and a headband with fabric detailed in red, cream, and gray, feet broken. So this is a bound Philistine chief. I'm just saying. He does not look like a dark-skinned Caucasian to me. So let's come over here just a little bit. I'm just going to read this part. This is about the Queen of Sheba. This is from the newworldencyclopedia.org. You guys can check out the links in the description, the link in the description to the sources. All right, let's see. Boccaccio's On Famous Women follows Josephus in calling the Queen of Sheba Nicola. Boccaccio goes on to explain that not only was she the queen of Ethiopia and Egypt, but also the queen of Arabia. Interesting. And she was descended from Ham. She is related to have had a grand palace on a very large island called Meroe. That name keeps coming up. Located someplace near the Nile River, practically on the other side of the world. From there, Nicola crossed the deserts of Arabia, though through Ethiopia and Egypt and up to the coast of the Red Sea to come to Jerusalem to see the great King Solomon. And again, we're going to talk about Menelik the First later on, the son between Solomon and Queen of Sheba, or Makeda, or as they called her here, Nicola. We're going to talk about their son. It's not recorded in the Bible, but it is recorded outside of the Bible. So it says she ruled Africa, Egypt, as well as Arabia. And this is that map that I showed you guys. The Middle East through the eyes of the ancient Israelites, reconstructed according to the documentary hypothesis, which we're not going to get into that right now. So let's see here. Contributions to the anthropology of Iran. Let's see. We're just going to read some of this right here. We're going to start. We'll start right. We'll just read this page. We'll read this page and then, yeah, and then we'll close out. So this right here is 1939, December 15, 1939, publications of the Field Museum of Natural History, Anthropological series. This is Henry Field, volume 29, number 1, Contributions to the Anthropology of Iran. Of the Gilzais, Sykes remarks that they are a mixed race. Today, they number perhaps 100,000 families and at one time were the most powerful tribe in the province of Kandahar. This concludes the anthropological passages selected, but there remains the various angles to the problem of the identification of the earliest inhabitants of Elam, Sumer, and Akkad. Talking about Nimrod territory. We're talking about the Elamites. So let's see what they conclude. Sykes contributes some suggestions regarding the origin and interrelation of these ancient peoples. He commences this dissertation by referring to the various names of Elam or Elamtu with its classical form Elamais, signifying mountains. The Assyrians came into contact with Elam in its mountainous section, and as in ancient times, its plains were far less extensive than today, and the mountains predominated. This name needs no further comment. The people of Susa termed their country Anzan Susunka and distinguished the various tribes given below. Strabo and the historians of Alexander similarly distinguished Susiana and Susis, the plain country, from the mountains of Kosia or Kissia, Paratakine or Paratakine, Mardia, Elamais, and Zuzia. The Book of Ezra 2 distinguishes between the Susanichians, or inhabitants of the plains round Susa, and the Elamites, or hill people. Ezra 4:9, Susanchites, and the Dehavites, and the Elamites. Under the Persians, the province was known as Uvaja. Finally, in medieval times, it was called Khuzestan, or the country of the Huz, or Khuz. And this name still lingers on the map, although the province is now termed Arabistan. D'Ulfoy and De Morgan, who both headed expeditions to Elam and who studied the question most exhaustively on the spot, concur in the opinion that there was a very ancient occupation of the Susian plains by Negritos, and that as far as is known, these were the original inhabitants. Again, there is a fact that in the most ancient bas reliefs, figures of Negritos appear with frequency, more especially in the case of the famous stele of Naramsin, where the monarch, who is of a Semitic type, is portrayed as leading Negritos to victory. Some years ago, during the course of many travels, I was puzzled by the extremely dark populations of the Bashargrid and Sarhad, very remote mountainous regions bordering on Persian Baluchistan. The solution may be that the whole country was originally populated by Negritos and the Anorioki, or non-Aryans of the Greeks. Non-Aryans, who probably stretched along the northern shores of the Persian Gulf to India, and that their descendants have survived in those distant parts. Hall would derive the dark section of the inhabitants of Elam and the Sumerians from this stock, and in my opinion, this would appear to be the soundest view to take a very difficult problem. Let me keep going. But Elam, in addition to the rich alluvial plain, also included the hill districts to the north and east, and here there is no question of a Negrito race. Consequently, there were in effect two races inhabiting Elam, the Negritos of the plain, who were very dark, and the white hillmen. This would appear to have been vaguely recognized by the Greeks. They describe Memnon, who came to the aid of Troy, as the offspring of a white mountain woman, Kissia, of the black Tithanos. He leads an army of Susians and Ethiopians. Tithanos is the Ethiopian god Dydon to the assistance of Priam. If you guys don't know who these people are I'm talking about, watch the movie Troy. It's entertainment, but it also has some of these names explained who these people are. In another passage, the Odyssey, Memnon, or Agamemnon in the movie Troy, is given the epithet of swarthy. When the Greeks found a black population in Elam, they would naturally compare it to the Ethiopians, of whom they knew through Egyptian sources, and this explains the transfer of Typhanos to Persia. At a rather later period, there was first a Sumerian and then a considerable Semitic influx, which in time, as in Babylonia, dominated and absorbed the earlier inhabitants of the country. As far as Babylonia is concerned, this Semitic invasion was mainly peaceful and perhaps would be described rather as penetrated. But in the case of Elam, probably owing to the mountain fatness, no permanent conquest was effected by the Semitic kings of Akkad. And it was not until the establishment of the Second Sumerian Empire by later kings of Ur that Elam became really subject to Babylonia, and then only for a short time. Y'all can go through and read all this yourself. I'm going to leave the link here for you guys. They said that they were black and swarthy, and that there were two groups of people. Let me go back. Two groups of people. Where was it at? Hold on, give me one second here. The white mountain woman, right here, the white hillman, Negritos of the plain, who were very dark, and the white hillmen. You're gonna hear about these white people in the hills and in the caves, and I'm not even being racist. I'm talking about historical references. These are not Dante's words. These are historical references that I've read to some of you guys before. Go check my Nephilim Giant series. Give me one second here. All right, so we have the Negritos. The Negritos are inhabiting Elam. We read what Harry Johnson said, the Negro in the New World. The Elamites of Mesopotamia appear to have been a Negroid people with kinky hair, and to have transmitted this racial type to the Jews and Syrians. So let's come down here. What did the Negritos look like? This is what you get when you Google Negritos. And it's going to come back, some of it, to the Philippines. Africans in Asia, known as the Negritos of the Philippines. This stuff ain't hard. Head and shoulders portrait of two Negrito women, each holding a baby. Philippine Islands. This is from the Library of Congress. See, if y'all, some people, they say, well, Google isn't a source. Google is an aggregator like a library. It pulls all the sources for you. You type it in, and it pulls the sources. This is the Library of Congress. Let me see if it's going to let me view the enlarged. These are Negrito women. These are Negrito women. Let me get off of her since her parts are showing. I'll put the... you guys can Google Negritos. I'm not going to have a link in there. You guys can Google this and look up stuff and see for yourself what these people look like. They're telling you that these Negritos inhabited Elam. Trying not to pull up no inappropriate pictures. Trying to keep it PG-13, at least. All right, but anyway, yeah, y'all can go check this stuff out. Y'all can pull up Negritos and see Negritos if you really want to see Negritos. But yeah, these are black people in the Philippines. All right, so now let's look at this. I'm going to close this out. Pictured postcard. A Vernal Mito Jew in Jerusalem, Library of Congress. When is this taken? 1921. Jamal Brothers, number 24, Jerusalem, Palestine, 1921. Why am I showing you this? Because later on we're going to get into the Yemenite Jews and the pictures taken in the 1920s that weren't released until the mid-2000s. I think it was 2016, 17, 18, somewhere around in there. We're going to get into that. And I thought this guy kind of looked like he could be one of Snoop Dogg's ancestors. It took me a second. I was looking at him. I was like, he kind of looked like Snoop Dogg. You know how the people be saying they see Jay-Z in pictures and Jay-Z's a time traveler? He looked like he could be one of Snoop Dogg's ancestors. Now, he don't look exactly like Snoop Dogg, but he looked like he could be a descendant or ancestor, not descendant, ancestor of Snoop Dogg. I don't know. I have no idea. I'm just saying. A lot of these people, this is, again, sorry, your Library of Congress calling him a Vernometo Jew in Jerusalem. I'm just saying. Anyway, if y'all enjoyed this study, I got more to come. Go ahead and press one. We're going to walk through this Bible. We're going to look at the racial references. We're going to look at the history. We're going to look at the geography. We're going to try to look at every aspect of this book, not just some of the book. We're not just going to preach the favorite lessons out of the book. We're going to talk about the stuff. Some of the stuff y'all going to like and some of y'all going to hate some of the stuff I'm bringing out. We're going to get some messages. We're going to get some medicine in the white bottles. We're going to get medicine from some brown bottles, some black bottles. We're going to get all kind of medicine. So if you did not like the study, please press 2. And while you're doing the pressing, make sure you press the like button. If you're new, make sure you hit the subscribe button. And most importantly, share this. If you want to support this ministry, you can hit the super chat anytime we're live. You can also support anytime you want with Cash App, #BHITB. PayPal link is in the description. The crypto links are in the description. And of course, you guys can support on the BHITB app. If you do not have it, go to blackhistoryinthebible.com, download the app, and click the support button at the bottom. So, with that said, next time we're going to be covering Jacob and Esau, and well, more so Esau. And then after Esau, we're going to get into the 12 tribes of Israel. We might have to double back to cover a few people. It's hard not to go, you know, way off track because they start to branch out into all these people the more, you know, more people are born in the Bible. So we're not going to touch every single person in the Bible, but we're going to touch a good deal of them. And we're going to talk about Esau mixing with Hamites because some people want to push the narrative that Esau is the white man, but it's not that crystal clear. Later on, Esau will mix with Kittim, but was it all of Esau? No. Some of Esau did mix with Kittim, and Kittim is associated with the Romans, but we also see that Esau mixed into other nations, so it's literally not just black and white when it comes to Esau, which is why I won't go as far as saying, well, Esau is the white man. That's misleading. It's only partially correct, and it's not even fully correct in that context because Esau is not all white men. So again, we'll get into that next time. So with that said, make sure you subscribe. Till next time, I'm out.